Thank you, Carol. This is indeed a good corner of the world here in Southwest Iowa today. Good morning.
Good morning, Merle.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The author of Psalm 122 wrote, "I was glad when they said to me, 'Let us go to the house of the Lord.' May the spirit of gladness be in the hearts of all who have come here to worship. We joyfully welcome you." In the news of our ministry together, this Wednesday evening, the mission committee will meet. Also, we need lay leaders. This isn't my most fun thing to do, but you all can do this. And we encourage you to sign up in the whiteboard at the back if you are able to do that. October is already all open for you all. So please sign up. The sensibility will be received today, so be sure and put your money in the little fish back there on the table, and that's where the collection plates are also. The annual congregational meeting where we receive the membership and other annual year-end reports is October 3rd. We encourage you to be here for that. We all now have a minute for mission from Mary Omar.
When the prophet Elijah, deep in the throes of existential crisis, fled to Mount Horeb in the search of God, he was met instead with a sound of sheer silence. Natalie Pisarek knows just how he felt. "There was a time in my life when I was on the bottom," Natalie testified during Sunday worship in her home congregation, First Presbyterian Church of Booton, New Jersey. "I cannot even describe how hard and difficult that time was. Only those who have been there know how it feels." Natalie's story recollected a significant turning point in her life. "On that fateful day, I went for a walk in a wooded area where I kept repeating over and over in my wounded brain how I would end the pain. As I walked, I came across a field, which oddly seemed to call to me. As I walked into the field, a beam of warm sunlight hit my face. It was at this exact moment that I realized I had made a terrible mistake. It was like God saying to me, 'What are you doing? You have a reason to live.' I was so overcome." Natalie found herself compelled to address the growing mental health crisis, not only by sharing her story with her church, but also by getting her congregation more involved. The church's board of deacons was persuaded to take immediate action to address the suicide crisis. Because deacons in the Presbyterian tradition are called to a ministry of compassion, witness, and service, the board voted to designate the church's share of Peace and Global Witness Offering to support the New Jersey chapter of the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, an organization which Natalie had participated for years. Natalie's personally moving experience resonates anew during the pandemic and underlines the importance of this work. "Sadly and tragically, our community has lost more people to suicide in 2020 than it has to COVID-19, said Natalie. Through the Peace and Global Witness Offering, congregations are encouraged and equipped to find and address the anxiety and discord that is prevalent throughout the world. The offering supports ministries that work for reconciliation and facilitate healing. Half of the Peace and Global Witness Offering goes to the national church to address these issues around the world. 25% is retained by congregations for local peace and reconciliation work, and 25% goes to mid-councils for similar mysteries on the regional level. As you may be aware, Shenandoah First Presbyterian Church will use our portion of the offering for local school nurse funds used for children in need." Natalie has a message to share with all of us during these unsettled times. She reminds us to listen and look for the light and remember that you have a purpose too. God is with you. Let us pray. Loving God, when we walk in the valley of the shadow, remind us that we are only steps from your light. Draw nearer to life by the arms of our shared ministry, all for who feel hopeless, lost, or deserted, in your loving embrace, into the warmth of your sight. Amen.
Thank you, Mary. Our gathering song is "We Are Standing on Holy Ground."
Standing on holy ground.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. If it had not been for God, who was on our side, we would have fallen prey to those who want to harm us.
We would have been swept away by sadness and fear. Blessed be the Lord, our protector.
God has broken the snare that took away our freedom. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
Blessed be God's holy name as we worship God.
Our hymn of praise is Praise Ye the Lord, the Almighty. God heals. God forgives. God longs for us to be whole. When we confess and turn toward God, we receive saving grace. Let us confess our failures and ways our lives have not reflected God's way. Let us pray. God of unity, we live in a world where our lives move between inclusivity and exclusivity. We often move toward the latter, trying to insulate ourselves from those who do not think like us, act like us, or look like us. Forgive our need to reject and to always be on the lookout for those things that make us different. Give us the eyes of our teacher who knows unconditional love and compassion and sees us all as one. We pray these things in his name. Amen. Please join me in the response of assurance of God's grace. Though we wander from the truth, God brings us back and saves our souls from death. Friends, believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Muriel. Thank you, Carol. I'm wondering about something here. I want to spend a little bit of time with my friends Brianne and Berkeley and Owen. Hi, Brianne. How are you today? Owen? Can I ask a favor of you? Could you come down and sit down here so that I can talk to everybody at the same time? Oh, I really appreciate that. Now, I need your help with something, okay? Thank you. Do you know how to count? 5. That was very good. Now, how many hands do I have? 5 hands. Boy, wouldn't that be something. I could drive and drink my coffee and hold the phone and 2 hands, right? 1, 2. How many hands do you have? 1. Now, this is going to get tricky. How many hands do we all have? Hold up your hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Is 8 more than 2? Mm-hmm. It is. So that if I just did something all by myself, that would be 2 hands, right? 2 hands. But what if we all did something together? Now that would be 8 hands. That would be more, right? I did something earlier, and I don't know if you've ever done this before. Have you ever traced your hand on a piece of paper? Mm-hmm. It reminds me of how important it is to do helpful things with our hands, right? And when we all do helpful things with our hands, it's more hands, isn't it? Why, maybe we could get people here today to raise their hands. Do you think we could, if we asked them nicely? Could you all raise your hands? Well, look at all those hands that are here to help. That's more than 8, isn't it? Okay, you can lower them now. That's so great. Now, I have something for you that you can probably take home or take downstairs. It reminds us of helping hands, okay? And how there are more hands to help there, aren't there? You're so welcome. You can trace your own hand on there. Or you can trace your hand on the back and add it to all those helping hands. Okay? Do you know how to? Oh, I don't know. It could be fun. But there's a lot of hands on there, isn't there? Mm-hmm. I know one other thing. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for giving us hands to help. Amen. Brianne, you are a great counter. There's 13 hands on here. That was fast counting, too. Now I think it's time to go downstairs for church school. And I'm so glad that you guys are here. Oh, and dude, so good to see you, ma'am. Thank you for all being here today and being my friends. And thanks to all of you for such good help with that. You are such good hand raisers. I'm going to invite you, friends, to join your hearts and minds and spirits together with me in a word of prayer. Sometimes, God, we need help to hear what you have to say. Sometimes we need help believing what you have to say. Sometimes we need help taking the things that you say to heart in ways that change us. We need all of these, God. We need to hear your word. We need to believe your word. We need to allow your word to shape us into the people you would have us be as individual followers of Jesus and as
a church and as followers all over the world, in this time and place, help us to hear what you have to say to us. And may we follow Jesus more closely because of it. For we ask this in his name. Amen. One of the defining features of the Gospel of Mark from cover to cover through all 16 chapters of Mark is how the people who should recognize Jesus and recognize what he's about as far as his mission and as far as what he has to do in bringing the kingdom of God near to people and having that close at hand, miss it. And the people who have been left out of things, the people who have been marginalized, the people who have been ostracized, see Jesus as saving grace embodied. Someone who recognizes them, someone who accepts them, someone who includes them. It makes for some tension. It makes for some conflict. But it ultimately makes for good news. All of those dynamics are at work in our Bible passage this morning from the 9th chapter of Mark, starting at verse 38. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him. For no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward." If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to have two feet and thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. This is the word of the Lord. So last week I saw one of those internet memes of a sign. And on this sign it read, "Now that we're back at work from COVID, we've started a new exercise program. It includes running amok, jumping to conclusions, passing the buck, pointing fingers, climbing the walls, and my favorite exercise of all, diddly squats." You know, I'm pretty good at some of those. And I know some other people who are too, and some people who were good at that. See, I wonder if the very first followers of Jesus, those first disciples of Jesus, that inner circle of the 12, had a copy of that meme posted on a bulletin board or on the refrigerator in the house that they stayed in while they were at Capernaum. Maybe it was something that Peter saw, or something that John and James saw, those two brothers, sons of Zebedee, whom Jesus nicknamed Sons of Thunder. He nicknamed that for a good reason. Maybe they saw it as often as they walked into the kitchen. And here's why I wonder that. They seem to have some of those exercises down pat. Especially the ones about jumping to conclusions and pointing fingers that really didn't amount to diddly squat. And I'm sure that there were times when that had Jesus climbing the walls. As we've noted the last couple of weeks from the Gospel of Mark, Mark is unflinching in describing those disciples in their most human moments and also in their least noble moments. Kind of like today's story. It begins with John, one of those brothers, one of those sons of thunder, coming to Jesus, tattling on another group that had been doing good things in the name of Jesus. They had been doing good things. They had been casting out demons, doing good things, healing people in the name of Jesus, and John wanted them to cut it out. It wasn't like they were selling fake watches on some corner. It wasn't like they were on the internet trying to pass off bogus Jesus Corporation life insurance policies. It wasn't like they were scamming anybody. They were healing people in the name of Jesus. And John jumped to the conclusion that because they weren't a part of his group, that Jesus would not give his seal of approval for what was going on. Because they were outsiders. John was pointing fingers at people who were obviously not followers like us. Which I'm not even sure I know what that means, as in followers like us. Because people are notorious for trying to whittle their group like us down to a select few like us. I don't even really know what John was so upset about. I know we're called to be discerning, but if Jesus isn't so worried about it, why am I so worried about it sometimes? Like, was John concerned that maybe somehow the name of Jesus would be misused or discredited? Or maybe some other rival group would steal their thunder, get too much credit? Or could it be that John and his friends were still struggling with the security that comes from labeling someone else as an outsider and us as insiders? Even after all that Jesus had said about taking up crosses and following him, even after all Jesus had said about what he really wanted was a bunch of servant leaders, that we're willing to serve everyone else? Isn't treating some like insiders and others like outsiders a perennial problem for every community, every culture, every group, every faith tradition? Sometimes we spend an awful lot of energy determining who's in and who's out. And in our own cultural context, friends, it's possible to hear Jesus' response to John's finger-pointing, to John's jumping to conclusions, as the polar opposite of how we relate to each other, how polarized things have become in the culture wars, on social media, in our politics. Jesus said, "Whoever is not against us is for us." Doesn't it seem like the general rule of thumb these days is more like whoever is not for us is against us? Examples of tribalism are not hard to find, and the effects of tribalism hurt us all and make us all less. Somebody always winds up getting hurt when the game is about who's in and who's out. And in response to what certainly sounds like Christian tribalism, Jesus seems to lower one bar significantly. It's as if Jesus needs to say to his friends and his followers, "Hey, let's make this more simple, shall we? Let's make it really simple. Anyone who gives a cup of water as a part of being of this Kingdom of God movement, well, you don't need to worry about them. Yeah? That's the admission fee. That's the cover charge for getting in on God's party. Cup of water." Something like going to a concert or a play and the price of admission is a can of food for the food pantry or a bottle of water that's later going to get distributed on the streets. Jesus makes it pretty simple and lowers the bar significantly as to who's a part of his gig, who's a part of this Kingdom of God thing. What we do need to defend against are the horrendous things done by those who claim to be followers of Jesus. The horrendous things that people sometimes do in the name of God. The horrendous things that people sometimes do in the name of religion or in the name of Jesus. Now that's what we really need to be on the watch for. Not who's in and who's out, but who's damaging other people. See that? Jesus lowers one bar really low, cup of water, that's cool. And Jesus raises the other bar really, really, really ridiculously high. Verses 42 through 48 of today's passage are some of the most disturbing words in the whole of the Bible. You know what I want to do? When I come to this passage, every time the Gospel of Mark comes around, I want to skip over that part. Huh? I want to end the passage by just saying, cup of cold water, cool. We're all good. Right? I like that part. Huh? Jesus says it's better to be drowned than to damage somebody. Jesus says it's better to do a self-performed hand or foot or eye-ectomy. Than to damage someone else. To, instead of giving them a cup of cold water to drink, you throw a cup of cold water on their hope in God, or the possibility of being a recipient of saving grace. Why would you want to throw cold water on somebody doing good? Of these verses, we can say some things. First of all, this part about cutting off hands and feet and tearing out eyes, being thrown into hell, having a millstone tied around your neck and tossed into Lake Manawa, that's hyperbole. That's exaggeration to make a point. You want to know how serious this is? It's this serious. Better something really bad like that happen than this over here. It's exaggeration. It's hyperbole. The second thing is, it's a pretty good passage to cite if somebody says that they take everything that's in the Bible absolutely literally. Like if it's in there, that's the way it is. And that's what I do. If that's true, then how come there aren't a bunch of one-armed, one-footed, one-eyed people running around? And you can say that everything in the Bible is literal, but I still see a lot of outwardly whole people. And the other thing that this passage does, these verses do, is they uncover something that Jesus was really, really, really serious about. Taking advantage of a vulnerable person, damaging someone who is vulnerable in their faith, or damaging someone who is seeking God in some way, shape, or form. Causing one of them to suffer is, according to Jesus, to invite severe judgment with hellish consequences. And there's a specific Greek word used by Mark to describe this thing. It's called scandalizein. If that sounds slightly familiar, scandalizein, it's because we have a cognate, scandalous. It's scandalous behavior. Jesus takes it out of the realm of tabloid items and puts it into the realm of relationships that have integrity. A few minutes ago, we heard it read as a stumbling block. That's scandalizein, a stumbling block. But New Testament professor Sharon Ring helps us to understand how the sense of this verb is more critical. It's like being so horrified that you simply cannot remain in the place or go forward along the path where you had the experience. It is something that is so repulsive that it turns you away. Now we can think of those things, can't we? Something so repulsive that it turns you away in a completely different direction. Something so traumatic as that. Have you ever heard somebody say that they just can't go down that highway anymore? They just can't take that road anymore that has that cross over on the side of the road because of what happened there to somebody that they cared about or loved or knew? I just can't go down J35 anymore. I can't do it. Too traumatic. Or how about this? Can you imagine somebody having something so horrible happen to them in the name of Jesus that they drop completely out of church? someone who's left the church because they've been abused by someone in the church, physically, emotionally, verbally. In some cases, it was intentional, and in other cases, it was a careless, casual word that made them feel less than a child of God, that somehow judged them and found them wanting for who they are. Jesus invites us to be discerning. Jesus never invites us to be judgmental about somebody else. Some never step foot in the church again. You know that there are new church developments and new church movements that are made up entirely of people that have been hurt and damaged by the church before in their past? Wouldn't it be great if church, the sanctuary, our gatherings was, wouldn't it be great if that was the safest place in town? Wouldn't it be great if coming to church was coming to a place where you knew for absolutely sure that you were going to be accepted for who you were? Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't it be great if a sanctuary was a sanctuary? We'd be turning people away for crying out loud. No, sorry, we don't have any more room here, but you can go down the street to the other place that's accepting and safe and loving and non-judgmental. They got room too. Wouldn't it be great to be a place of solace? To not be worried about who's in or who's out or who believes in Jesus like I believe in Jesus. Because that's evidently the only way to believe in Jesus. Jesus reserved some of his harshest words for those who might turn someone else off to God or turn someone else off to him. Or stop somebody from doing good. You know, years ago there was a Christian teacher who had a specific exercise that they did with their students. They would have their students get into a great big circle, physically, a great big circle. We're not going to try it today. But it would be an interesting experiment for some other Sunday, maybe. Great big circle facing each other. Not facing outward, facing inward. And next, the teacher invited the students to start to imagine God at the center of the circle. Well, isn't that great? God at the center. Part of where God should be. You are out. The squirrel running over across the roof over there. We do have certain standards. We'll see how inclusive we are, right? When the squirrel starts running between our legs. God at the center of the circle. And then has the students start moving toward the center, toward God. And what happens is, when the students did that, the circle shrank in size, of course, but each of the students eventually wound up shoulder to shoulder. You get close enough to God, you get closer to each other. It's a thing. I like that, but I think the real trick is with the circle. I think the real trick is making sure that everybody's in the circle to begin with. Jesus seemed to think so too. Our hymn of response, friends, this morning is called As Partners in Christ's Service. No, I'm done. I'm done for the day. How could he possibly offend anyone further? As we enter into a time of prayer together, I would invite you to continue to hold up the people that are on the prayer list that is included in the bulletin in your prayers during the course of the week as we are apart from one another. All of those people and their needs. And as we join together in this prayer, I invite you to also, we'll begin with a time of silence where you can offer up your own prayers. We trust, holy and gracious God, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. That you see us exactly as we are and you love us more than we can imagine. We trust that you are at work in all things for good. Even when it doesn't seem like it or feel like it. And we trust that we are called to a purpose and a life that's bigger than ourselves. So today we offer our thanks. We offer our thanks for all the good things. On this beautiful day that we gather for worship, we are surrounded by beauty. Help us to appreciate and savor and be aware of how precious the gift of life is today, which we received by your grace, and the new life that you give us each and every day in Jesus. Especially, God, we thank you for families, for the love that we share in families, and for the laboratory that families are for getting along with people that sometimes drive us crazy. We give you thanks for the support of friends. The friends that we've had for life, the friends that we're making today, the friends that are yet to be. We thank you that you continue to give us strength and abilities to serve your purposes. We may not have as much strength as we used to have, and you continue to give us opportunities to make a difference where we are, as we are, with what we have and what we can do. We thank you for this community in which we live. And we give you thanksgiving for all the opportunities that you give us to pass it forward, to pass it on, to give as we've received. Even so, God, there are parts of our lives and parts of our world and parts of our community that are not the way we want them to be or the way they are supposed to be. And we commit ourselves today to do what we can, but to trust you to do what we cannot. We pray for those who are overwhelmed these days, God, by life, by changes, by complications, by trying to manage in a stressful world. We pray for those who are exhausted from change and from uncertainty and from responsibilities. We pray for the people that we know and love that are ill and their caregivers and people we will never meet who are ill and for their caregivers. God, you call us to journeys where we cannot see the destination. Sometimes in some unfamiliar paths. Give us the faith to go out with courage, not knowing where we go, but only that where we go, you accompany us and you will lead us to the places where we belong. We ask these things and pray these things and the things that were lifted up in silence in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who continues to teach us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Having received God's love, having known God's grace, having felt God's saving touch in our lives, friends, we're invited to respond by sharing the love, sharing the grace, sharing the goodness. We continue to offer our tithes, our gifts, our resources, who we are and what we have. The offering plate is on the table behind the pews, as is the 2 cents a meal offering. I invite you to contribute toward both of those before you leave this morning. The 2 cents a meal offering goes toward hunger ministries here locally in Shenandoah and in southwest Iowa and around the world. 2 cents each meal for every person in a family. And as a part of that, I invite you to pray with me in dedicating those gifts for God's purpose through the prayer that is offered in the bulletin. Let us pray. Blessed be the Lord, for God is good, and God's steadfast love endures forever. Our Creator, help us to mirror your goodness through this offering for the life of the world. Amen. Let's join together, friends, in our closing hymn, May the God of Hope Go With Us. Please join me in our responsive benediction found in the bulletin. Let the name of Christ be the word we speak, the grace we show, and the love we share. May the Spirit of the Lord rest upon us, the word of the Lord live within us, and the glory of the Lord shine around us this day and always.